cybersecurity and all that. But I'd like to start out with sort of the news of the day, and that is the issue down on the border. Obviously, a lot's been made about the separation of families. And of course, I know yesterday the president signed an executive order to keep the families together. So I want to give you a chance to sort of comment on that.
Sure. Well, first of all, thank you for having me. It's always such a pleasure to be able to not only talk about the mission of DHS, but very importantly, to be able to tell you all the good things the men and women are doing every day as they seek to protect our country. So thank you for the opportunity.
Thanks.
So this is a very difficult and complex issue, as you know. It's one that presidents have struggled with for decades. It's one that Congress has struggled with for decades. What the president did yesterday is to try to make clear that what we don't need to do as Americans is pit the enforcement of law against our humanitarian ideas. So we need to do both at the same time. So what he tried to do is enable us to do that until Congress acts. But I want to be very clear on this. Congress has the authority and responsibility to make the law of the land and to fix the immigration system. That ends up being as part of their systems, part of their assets, part of their networks. Where did it come from? You know, did they check it? Did they check it for vulnerabilities? Do they continually update and patch? So that supply chain issue is something we all have to be very, very mindful of. Foreign influence. Boy, are they active, right? And here I think it's very, I want to be very clear on this. This is not a question of the substance. The substance is not terrorist content on the internet. The substance itself is 99% of the time protected under our First Amendment as it should be.
With that nightmare scenario, it's a great way to end. And Secretary, thank you so much for being here.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you.
You're great. Good to meet you.
Thank you.
Gambit of issues, and I think the department's role is one of the most difficult in the United States. But I'd like to start with some of the most recent threats we saw play out.
You got it, no particular order. The relationship with the Five Eyes is strong and important.
And I would add RT to that list as well. But looking at that particular set of issues and looking that the department is now handling nation-state threats in all of its various forms, whether through proxies, and I think you rightfully said in your remarks that what should we be thinking about in terms of 5G? Because when I look at the critical infrastructure, that's at the very heart of it all. So if you want to touch on that, and if you want to discuss Huawei and ZTE in particular, you're more than welcome to. So their charm campaign is on and on, but there are some legitimate risks.
Because we do have a weak link in cyber, what we hope to do is to identify these vulnerabilities, take them out whenever we can within DHS authority, but ensure that the average consumer, the average American really understands what they're up against, which is a nation state.
Manned aerial vehicles and the like. What should we be worried about there? What is the department doing to enhance some of our security protocols and measures? And particularly some lessons learned from maybe the most recent national security special event in with the Super Bowl in Atlanta, Cyberside. So what surprised you on that side, right?
We need to do more, mm-hmm. right? We need to take it to the next level.
Phenomenal overview of what keeps you up at night, and the rest of us can sleep a little better since you're on the job, on the ball. We at Auburn University, I think, have stand ready to help in whatever way we can. Madam Secretary, thank you.
Thank
you for your leadership, and thank you for joining us today.
No, thank you, my pleasure. I focus a lot on systemic risks. We can't really miss the forest by looking at individual trees. We have to look at the whole picture. Privacy is really interesting because at the end of the day, it really emanates from a cultural environment. So for example, as you say, in Europe, they do have this concept of right to be forgotten. We haven't seen that become a norm or established practice in the United States. Another example I would use is an alert and warning. In Europe, you have to opt out most places because they believe that the security is more important than privacy.
Nina Gardner, professor of business and human rights at Johns Hopkins SAIS in Washington. I wanted to ask you about family separations.
Well, thank you for the way in which your question was asked. I would say that at DHS, we enforce the law.
Good.
As you know, I could talk about this all day. So let me
see. And you know these issues inside now.
Let's see if I could focus on these. First of all, I think we have to prioritize.
Will it be the people who actually know? Of course, lawyers know everything. And we have a lawyer here. But who ultimately is going to call that shot?
So
what would that look like in the sit room?
So what we're working on right now, two things. First of all, we got to attribute faster, right? We just have to bring everything we have to bear, particularly with our allies, so that we can name names as soon as possible, not many months later. So that's step one. Back from Hawaii last week, it's a great example of some relentless resilience.
I guess you didn't get to enjoy the weather.
They started with these monumental floods in April. Went through volcanoes, went through hurricanes, went through forest fires in the middle of the hurricanes, one of the islands, then ended up with more flooding and mudslides. And this was all in the span of a few months in one state, one group of islands. Wow. So you do have to keep operating. I mean, the point is you have to find ways to have redundancy, to think about reconstitution, to really adapt and innovate while under attack, whether it's from a natural disaster or it's a man-made attack.
And ways to demonstrate to the voters that their vote counted and was counted correctly.
But I read this weekend that I understand that Congress had allocated $308 million. DHS gets to decide on the states where they're getting that money. Do you think the states are spending that money wisely?
Asking you about your decision to sign a memo in April of 2018 that endorsed separating families at the southern border.
Right, and it did not.
Did people ever specifically raise to you the concern that children would be traumatized as a result of this policy?
Not when I was writing, not during that.
To you. You never heard those concerns?
Not from staff, no.
I mean, for Congress about this policy as well in May of 2019, and you said that no parents were deported without the chance to reunite with their children. We now know that hundreds of parents were deported without their children.
So
why did you say what you said?
Yeah, so that's ongoing litigation.
The U.S. government is currently not doing everything possible. It's led largely by immigration groups and by nonprofits.
Yeah, I'm not in the government right now, but I'm also not part of Health and Human Services.
You are with the administration right now, though, right? You did accept a position with the Advisory Council.
I'm not with the administration right now.
Seeing the White House. Can I ask what led you to resign?
And by the way, so are other CEOs, though. I mean, are you telling every CEO in here that they should never advise the government on how to make something work?